Hi everyone, welcome to our lecture. From now on, we will use Zoom instead of Google Meet for lectures because starting on September 30th, Google Meet will stop working for over 100 students, and currently we have more than that in the class. Currently joined, we have 160 students in the class, but currently joined, we have 103 and growing. Also, they disable recording starting September 30th, so Zoom is our only option for this class. However, the office hours will continue to use the old Google Meet since we don't record them and we never have over 100 students in the office hours. So if you want to follow up office hours, they are sorted by days. So you can basically find easily the TAs or me that are available on a certain day. And our office hours are posted in post number 7. But for lectures, we'll use Zoom instead of Google Meet. So please use the Zoom for lectures. And just one more time, let's make sure that there is no one waiting in the Google Meet. No one else is there. Good. Okay, so today's lecture will be on jQuery. We'll continue our web technologies that we started with HTML, CSS, then basic JavaScript, HTML DOM, and JavaScript functions to update the DOM. And today we learn the jQuery library, okay? Now, the assignment is still due next week, homework number 2. And there were several questions on Piazza about this homework. You don't need to read the CSV file from JavaScript. Please follow the various responses that we gave you. Basically that what you have to do is not to read the CSV file, but transform it into a JavaScript array, like the one that was proposed in post number 33, and then embed it in HTML. And in post 33, Matt transformed that into a set of variables, which each one of them is an array in JavaScript. And then one array at the end, that is the array of all the courses. So that's one way to do it. Another way to do it is to actually use an array of objects in JavaScript. But there is really, this is one way, and if you try to do it this way, it's probably a good way to do it. Okay, so that it's administrative information. Let's see if there are any questions in the chat. And there are no questions for now. I found Zoom a little bit more difficult to use to see the chat because it's not going to show me when there are questions in the chat. So please just unmute yourself and ask the questions. It's otherwise impossible to take any kind of questions. One other thing that I found yesterday I taught CSC 260 and I had to record 3 times because the first 2 times something went wrong. Either the voice was not recording or it was not sharing, or as I said, basically there are all kinds of weird things happening that you don't see actually the big black bar that is the Zoom bar on top. Anyway, so thank you, Ricky. Basically, we'll record the lecture and post it after the class, hopefully on YouTube and Zoom as we did before. Okay, so we'll basically talk about jQuery today. So what exactly is jQuery? It's a JavaScript library, and there are many JavaScript libraries, but jQuery was one of the first that simplified the access to the DOM and the ways to update the DOM to respond to events and basically a lot of functions that we are going to use in this class. It makes several tasks easier, not basically different, but not anything extra to what we already learned about JavaScript updates to the DOM. the functions that we talked about last class: get element by ID, get element by class, get element by tag. It just makes the whole thing much easier, and also to attach events, actions to the events that happen on various tags in the HTML DOM. It's browser independent. The implementation is basically done for all browsers. Chrome is the default, but and Mozilla, but really it works on Edge, Safari, Opera, or any other browsers that you have. The capabilities include HTML DOM manipulation. So first we learn how to write selectors to select objects in the DOM, in the document object model of the HTML document. Then we will learn to do CSS manipulations, modify the style of tags, HTML event methods, how to react to events in the HTML DOM, effects and animations. We will not go into details about that. Well, we'll see simple examples of fading or sliding up, sliding down. And something that we don't cover in this class is responses to basically AJAX. AJAX are updates that do not require the entire update of the page, but smaller parts of the page are updated by calls to the server. Since we haven't done yet server-side scripting, we'll not cover AJAX today. That will be a topic of one of the following classes. Next class, we'll actually talk about HTML canvas. So basically a way to draw and implement games in HTML. Drawing, making figures, implementing basically everything that you would do in a standalone application that uses graphics. So let's first start with how do you embed, add jQuery to your website. Basically, there are different ways. You can download it from jQuery.com. It's basically the main website where jQuery is released. You can go to download, and the latest version is 3.5.1. You can download the production version or the development version. When you download, usually download the compressed version, which looks extremely compressed, but it's basically the one that is used for getting jQuery in the most efficient way. It doesn't take a long time to load the entire JavaScript library. Now, so there are two basically versions available: the production version, which is the tested version that should be used for live websites. Use the compressed release, as I said. The development version has the latest features, but really you should be very careful that even if these functions are available, they may not be completely bug-free. Now, there are multiple ways to use jQuery. The best way for you is to actually place the library in the same folder with your web pages. That way you know that they are available. It's available in the same way that your HTML web pages are available. So basically you are the host for both your libraries and your HTML pages. And to include it, if it's is put in the same folder with your web pages, the advised way to load it is basically to embed it as a script in the head. So you can see script source jQuery 3.5.1 minimum JS, and it basically loads the entire jQuery library. Now, you can also include jQuery directly from the website. So instead of putting here the location on your own server, you can put the location on the jQuery.com server, or you can include it from a content delivery network. So these are basically networks like, for instance, Google or Microsoft, that have all the APIs, all the JavaScript libraries that you would need, okay? And here is the way to include it from the Google network. Now, the syntax for selecting DOM elements is the following. So If you remember, for JavaScript, we would actually write the JavaScript function document.getElementById or document.getElementById class. And that is all abstracted away by jQuery. jQuery is, in fact, kind of like a syntactic sugar over JavaScript. So it allows for a simpler syntax to select elements in your and actually filter on versus types of elements in your document. So the syntax for it is dollar sign and then open parenthesis the selector. This is the query that finds the elements, and we'll see a couple of them below. And then dot action, and you basically execute the action that is that basically you want to run for that specific element. Now, you can use this CSS selector syntax, which below you basically have the examples. If you want to select all elements with a certain tag, like for instance, for all paragraphs, hide them, that will basically select all paragraphs. If you want to find all of the elements within some class, and that basically the notation in CSS is dot and then the name of the class, you can also select those and hide them. If you want to select the elements with a given ID, like for instance the ID test, you would use this hash sign to select that element. So let's actually see an example. And this is a very simple example. Let me actually discuss it first. This is an HTML file that basically I used also in the previous class. I'm loading the jQuery library directly from the download website, jquery.com. And I'm creating one div, one h1 tag, and three paragraphs. So if you load this HTML page, it will look something like this. Basically, hello world. This is a text from paragraph one. This is a text from paragraph two. And this is the text from paragraph four. Now in the console or part of a script that you load in the page, you can basically use jQuery. In this case, because we already loaded the jQuery, you can select all paragraphs, all tags with tag P and hide them. And then basically it will look like this. So I have several examples. So in the next steps, I will just do these examples in Visual Studio Code. So let's create a folder that we will include in our workspace. Let's call it js_examples. And start VS Code. So this starts fresh. We haven't added yet any folders. Let's add JS examples. And we have nothing yet there. So let's create a file, index.html. And currently this file is totally empty. So the first document that we start with is this simple document that has several tags. It basically has three paragraphs. And if we run it with live server, it basically looks like this. Hello world. This is a text from paragraph one, paragraph two, and paragraph four. We can start the developer tools. Ctrl-Shift-I is on Windows. And now we can basically write jQuery because the library is loaded. So in our case, I want all paragraphs and I want to hide them, which exactly that's what happened. So before it basically looked like this, all the paragraphs were shown. And now we selected all paragraphs with jQuery and we hid all those paragraphs. And basically this is what jQuery can do, a simplified way to get the element without having to get it using methods like we did in JavaScript before. So before for something like this, we would have to do document.getElementById tag, actually by name, by tag name. And then we would basically get all the elements that are paragraphs But now we are using jQuery. I'm not exactly sure what I didn't catch as an example, but it's okay. Okay, good. Some of you may actually, it's capital N. Yes, N has to be capitalized to basically get the correct tag. Okay, good. So let's return back. So another example is get elements by ID. So in the same example that we had before, we have paragraphs with IDs, ID 1, ID 2, ID 4. And if we want to get the elements by ID, we can basically also write a jQuery. Let's refresh this. And again, dollar sign. And the ID, the element with ID 1, which is actually the first paragraph, dot hide. The action that we are going to do is to hide the first element. So you can see in the source that we also had before that basically there is only one that has that ID. If you have also class, then we can do that. So let's just say that we also have several elements that have a certain class, like class 1. And we want to hide, select them all and hide them all in one jQuery. So let's close this, refresh, and now get all the elements under class 1 and hide all of them. And that will hide the first two paragraphs that we have here. And only the fourth paragraph is shown. So it's very similar to what we were doing with JavaScript, only that now it's a very short and concise notation. Okay. So that basically is the next example that you will find in the lecture notes. So all of these ways is about selectors, but there are many more other things that you can do with selectors. So more on selectors is that you can select all the paragraphs under some tag, like paragraph in this case, under some class. So very simplified, instead of actually selecting everything with a certain class, and let me show you directly in the example. So in this example, we had two paragraphs that were under class 1 and one that was not under class 1. So instead of writing everything under class 1, I can write all of the paragraphs under class 1. And the same thing will happen because there are only paragraphs under a class 1 anyway. So this is a filtering under a certain tag. Another thing that you can do is for lists, unordered lists, you can select for the first unordered list, the first list item in that unordered list. Or in all of the possible unordered lists, you want to select the first item and then basically hide it. Or you can select any element with an href attribute. So within the brackets, you can put the attribute that you want to hide or to do something with. Another example, for all the anchors, I want those that will open in a different tab. So the target attribute has the value underscore blank. So these are all the anchors with the target attribute equal with blank. If I have a table, I can select all of the rows, that all of the even rows, like second row, fourth row, sixth row, or all of the odd rows, okay? So let's do a couple of these examples. For instance, the first example. Let's assume that we have in our table, let me take out the paragraphs and just use unordered list. So UL, and under this unordered list, I'm going to put several items. So maybe I have a list item 1, which basically is this text 1. Maybe I have multiple list items, 1, 2, 3. And let's say that I have two such lists. I have one list and another list, okay? So now if I go back to my document, I basically see that I have two lists and I can start using those tags that we learned. So Java jQuery and now under UL, li first. So for the first list, I want the first list item to disappear. And as we can see, basically from the first list, the first item will disappear. Okay. So that's basically the first tag, that the first list item of the first unordered list will disappear. If I want the first item of every unordered list to disappear, then let me refresh. And instead of for the first one, I will hide the first child of every unordered list will disappear. So now we can basically see that I had two lists and for both lists, the first child disappeared. Now let's assume that in these lists, I have anchors. So maybe I have an anchor for our class web page. So this would be HTTP, www3.cs.stonybrook.edu, tilde Pfodor, tilde courses, tilde csc316.html. And this would be an anchor for csc316. And let's say that all my references are like this. So I have another reference for csc216 and maybe another one for csc416. So this is 216, 316, 416 with the corresponding links. And I want to hide all of them. Okay. So in my web page, I have the list of the various classes and the links will basically take the user to different classes. And now I write a Java jQuery that selects all of the anchors with href. And in fact, all of the anchors have href. So all of the elements with attributes href and hide them. And now we basically saw that's exactly what happened. So I basically selected all of the items with attribute href and I hid them. Okay. So that's another attribute that we can use. And the other ones are self-explanatory. Basically, if you have anchors whose target is a new tab like underscore blank, I can select all of them and I can modify the href. I can modify the text within that anchor and everything like that. Similarly for tables, I can select even rows and odd rows. So here are the examples that I wanted to discuss. If you want to ask a question, you can just unmute yourself. I saw an image, so I guess somebody was basically showing their camera. Okay, so these are the examples. P.class1 selects all of the paragraphs with class one. P.first selects the first paragraph that I can basically get from the list of all the paragraphs. UL li first will basically select the first list item from the first unordered list. And ULLI first child will select the first item from every unordered list. And selecting all of the hrefs will basically all of the attributes, all of the tags with attribute href. Okay, what else can Java jQuery do? It supports catching most DOM events. So for instance, if you click on a certain object or a tag, or if you double click on an object, or if you enter an object or leave an object, and these are the ones that we are going to implement ourselves. Similarly, for inputs in forms, you can get the keys pressed, the if a key is just pressed but not released, and when the key is released. So all of these type of events are captured, and many other events, like for instance, for form events, you can get the event of submitting the form, or changing the form, or change, or focusing on a certain input. And for document events, you can basically capture the loading of a document, the resizing of a document, and the scrolling, if you have, for instance, an image as a document, scrolling through that image can be captured in jQuery. And we'll see a couple of examples. So first of all, the syntax to get these events, DOM events, in jQuery. First of all, you find the element with the same selector that we had before, dot the event name, the event on which you want to watch, like for instance, click or mouse over. And then the action to be performed, which usually is specified through an anonymous function or a function call. So JavaScript is the perfect example of basically functions as arguments to other functions. So you can define a new function at this point to define what basically will be executed when that event is captured, or you can invoke another function defined somewhere else in JavaScript. We are going to take the first way. We are going to define our actions right here. So this is the first example. So basically, let's assume that we have the same file that we had before. We had paragraphs with IDs, ID 1, ID 2, ID 4. And then we want to capture when the user enters or in a certain object, like basically the mouse goes over the paragraph with ID 1. So the mouse enters over that and display an alert that basically you entered the paragraph 1. Okay. So let me actually show you in VS Code. I'm going to use the same file as before. And right now, if I go over paragraph 1, it basically displays an alert. So I'm capturing the event that the mouse goes over the paragraph 1, and an alert is going to be basically displayed. So 1 will select the paragraph with ID 1. And then for the event mouse enter, the action is a function, and this function is an anonymous function. Basically, it specifies that when the mouse, its function open close parenthesis is just an anonymous function. You are not giving a name, but you are defining the body of that function. And in this case, an alert that you entered in paragraph 1 is displayed. Okay. Another example. For instance, I want when the focus for a certain input is in that specific object. So here is an example. I'm having basically an HTML document that has a form, and within that form, there is an input field, and in that multiple input fields, but only one I'm interested in, the input field with ID last name. And basically what I want to do in this example is that for that input field with ID last name, when the user goes with a cursor in that specific field, so the focus is now on that input field, the function that gets executed is that I'm getting the current element. And one tag that I haven't discussed about is this. So this is, once you are inside the field, like for instance, the field with ID name, this takes the current field. So $this is basically how to get the current field. So for the current object, I'm basically changing the style, the CSS style property background color to a version of gray. So which is basically the Unicode in hexadecimal CC, CC, CC. So one thing that I should probably specify here is that there is dollar sign this. It's similar to what we have in Java. Selects the current object or jQuery object. So in this case, I already have an object. So I'm actually selecting the current input, but really the input here is this L name that I have below. So L name in this case, the current input and is with ID. So basically it selects the current input and it sets the color to that gray color. I saw that there was a question in chat. You don't see the chat. So this is the input type in this case. It's actually this in this case, because you are already in one ID is the current object. So because we are writing an anonymous function, which is an argument of focus under an object that was already selected in jQuery, which was the L name, it's basically this refers to that object that was above. So it's not a tag, like for instance, you would have P, because that has to be specified as a string, like we specified with P like before. This is really a way to get, it's like a keyword in Java. It takes the current object and you are already in the object, in the jQuery object that has the ID last name, okay? So this is basically the current object that is selected for this focus. You are in the R in the function focus for that current object. So it's basically a way to reference instead of writing again ID last name dot CSS to set a property, you can basically just use this. It's a short way. Everything about jQuery is short way to do something. It's a syntactic sugar over pure JavaScript. That's what it is. Okay. Any questions? Okay. Now, what about handling multiple events? So I want when I enter with the mouse to change the color, when I exit with the mouse to change the color, and when I click on that specific object to change the color. So basically I can select in this case, all of the paragraphs. On specifies multiple events. And then basically I have this JavaScript. It looks like a JSON, but it's really a JavaScript object, which specifies that for the key mouse enter, this is the function that will be executed. So it's key value pairs. And on takes an array of such, or an object of such key value pairs. So it's really an object in JavaScript, but the value of basically properties are functions themselves. So in this example, all that I'm doing, I'm changing the colors of the background. The moment that I enter on any paragraph, it changes the background color to light gray. When I leave a certain paragraph, it changes the background color to light blue. And when I double click or I click on a certain paragraph, I'm changing the background color to yellow. And you can see that I'm actually using this in all of these cases. So I already selected every single paragraph one by one. And for every one of them, this will refer to that one paragraph and it will change its color. So let me actually do this example. So let's change the script here. And instead of just displaying an alert, I'm going to, for every paragraph, the ones that I have above, I'm basically adding this function that when I move the mouse over that paragraph, it will change the color to light gray. When I leave a paragraph, it changes to blue. And when I click, it changes to yellow. So this is exactly that same example. And you see, I entered each one of them. It changes the colors as I basically enter and exit. If I click on one, it changes not only the color, but also it changes the color to a different color, okay? So light gray when I enter, blue when I leave, yellow when I click on it. And this is done on every single paragraph. So let's see, there are some questions in the chat. You don't see the chat, but I basically see it, and it will not be recorded either, the chat. So can we do multiple events on the same action? Like you do two things that happen with a click? Yes, I believe that you can. You can attach them, but I think you have to attach them as separate functions. So basically you can't add them in the same multiple event. You basically have to add them in separate focus functions. So then basically both of them will be executed at the same time, I believe. I would advise to try it. I haven't tried it. I haven't tried that feature. Let's see what other questions are in the chat. I think you just put that in the same action, and I would advise to try it. I don't know if it actually works. So let me actually, let's try it. We are fine with trying it. So let me add, then when I enter on a paragraph, multiple actions will be executed. And the second action is not only changing the background color, but changing the color to a different color, like red. Okay. I haven't tried it before, but it seems that it works. So it's not only that it changes the background color, it also changes the color of the text. Let me try to put them into the same object. I don't think that will work because I already have mouse enter. So it looks to me that it doesn't change the background. So the moment that you have the second one, the first one is invalidated. So that's why I put it in a separate, basically object. So this will basically work. Yeah, it changes both the background and the color for that text. So it basically responds to your question, Ricky. Can you add the action directly after line 18? Yes, that's very good idea. So you basically, here you have a block with multiple actions. So you can basically just add it as a sequential action. Very good question, very good idea. The same thing happens. It's an entire block that will be executed every single time. Two different things at the beginning when put them at the start. Yes, you are completely right, Ricky. Okay, good. So that clarifies things. Let me close the chat. Good, thank you. Now, a different example. So actually it's the same example. I'm just showing how it looks. It's the same example. Okay, effects. So jQuery also supports various effects. We have used hide, which basically makes an object disappear. But we can actually use show or toggle, which switches between hiding and showing an element. And really is something that you can use for your homework. So toggle would be something that when you click on it, it will hide. When you click again, it will show. So it basically, it's a way to showing and hiding a certain element. So in this example, let me actually go directly to here. So I have this code that basically shows the different paragraphs. And you saw earlier that I can select some paragraph, like for instance, for all paragraphs or the paragraph with ID 1, I can hide it. Probably we haven't named these paragraphs. Let me take a look, view source. No, I did name them. Ah, it's not class. So for the paragraph with ID 1, I hide it, and if I want to show it, I show it back. And another way is to toggle it. So toggle basically shows and hides them. So it's really basically flipping to show it and to hide it. So again, if you want to embed it in the homework, you can basically do it very easily. So let's basically do it in a simple way. Let's say that this is CSC 316 and each class is preceded by the title of that class. So I'm going to have an H1 with ID CSC 316 title. And CSC 316 text. And now I basically end this object. And then I have some class, some text for CSC 316. This is the text from CSC 316. And now I can basically add. So basically what I want is for the object CSC 316 title, I'm selecting it and on mouse on click, the function that will execute is that I select another object. So let's see if this works. CSC 316. And I'm gonna toggle it. Okay. And it looks to me that I have some error. Good. So now let's see how this works. I haven't tried this one, but click, click should have. So when I click on the object in the title, I need to select it as an object. So when I click on the object in the title, it shows the description of that specific, of that class. So this is another way to implement the homework. And this time you can use jQuery. So for object in the title, on mouse click, the object, which is the basically the next object that is the description, will toggle. So it basically flips from on to off. And you can do it for every single other class. So you can basically do this similarly for 416 with the text for 416. And you can basically do the same function as we had in the other script, but for 416. So let's do it. For 416, similarly, like, I don't want this, I want this. Or you hide them by default and then you show them. So let's basically do that. We start by selecting hide everything. So CSC 316, hide it. And do the same for 416. And now select them as identifiers. So now basically it shows all of the classes and then you show the ones that you are interested in and you close them down. Okay, it's really, you can play with it. Excellent. Yeah, you're allowed to use anything in JavaScript, including jQuery, as long as you don't forget to embed it. And you have to embed it from a content network because you are only allowed to submit one HTML. It's the requirement of the homework. But you can use basically this. This is always up and that will work fine. Okay, excellent question. Is it possible to include more than one object in a single selector? With ID, I do not think so. With a tag, yes. So with ID, I don't think you can enumerate multiple objects. I don't think it's possible. But it seems that it is, because it seems that it worked. So, yes. I just included it. Another question is, can you use regex? I don't know. Question mark, maybe? No. So I'm not exactly sure how to do regex in JavaScript. I have to confess that. Probably escape sign, I don't think so. Nope. Double escape, nope. So I do not think so. I do not know how to do it. But I will find out by next time. Good. Very good. Very good questions. Okay. Next, you can actually hide with a certain speed. You don't have to hide it immediately. So let me show you an example. Let's say that I want to hide those titles, or maybe I show these and I want to hide them. And I can now select on every paragraph, and for every paragraph, hide it within 1 second. You enter the time in milliseconds. So now it disappears in 1 second. And if you want, you can toggle within 1 second. So it appears in 1 second, it disappears in 1 second. You can make this 3 seconds or 4 seconds. And it's basically, it's a way to hide and show. Moreover, you can actually give also a callback function. So like in the example that we have here, I also want to trigger an alert test. So that's a callback. It's basically a function that is also called the moment that that action is started. So I toggle in 3 seconds, but I also, I create an alert, and I basically, let's say, toggle as the alert. So now we basically got an alert and also the hiding and the unhiding and the showing. So it's basically toggle takes the time as an argument if you pass one argument, or it takes the time and a callback function, a function that will also be called in addition to the current function that you are running. Wait, so lots of things. Yeah, go ahead.
I have a question. Is the callback function called before or after?
It's called the moment that you are calling the first one. So this time will not be actually starting until you finish the callback function. So it's a synchronous call, because if you see, if I'm running this command, it first puts the alert, and only when I finish that alert, it starts showing the text. So it showed, it's called before it actually executes toggle.
Thank you.
Welcome. Fade out and fade in. Basically, it's, they are similar to hide, but instead of shifting up and down, it disappears slowly. So fade out is kind of similar to hide. So let me show it to you. So for all the paragraphs, let's eliminate the callback function and just fade out. And slowly, you see in 3 seconds, the text disappeared. It didn't, it's not hidden up and down, but it's fade out and fade in. And now it slowly appears. And similarly, you have fade toggle, which basically disappears and appears slowly. Okay, so those are fade toggle. Slide up is the default that you are getting when you have hide. You have also slide down and slide toggle. So these are animations. So let's go with slide. Slide toggle. So now it slides up. It shows by sliding down. Let's say that I want to slide up and slide down. These are all cool for animations. If you implement a game or you want to implement something like a PowerPoint presentation and you want animations on your PowerPoint. Okay, next. These are all examples. You can pass in the time, or you can pass one of the three constants, slow, fast, or medium, basically. And those are also arguments. They are like default values for slow. I don't remember how much it takes, but probably around 3 seconds for slow, about 0.5 seconds for fast. Now, actions. So remember last time we had a way to remove a child. So basically for the same kind of example that we have here, I got the element at by ID 2, then I got for that element the parent node, and then I removed the child with the document with the element with ID 2. And this was a button. So for this code, basically it created a button that allowed me to remove the second paragraphs in the paragraph in the code. Let's save it. So this is, for some reason it didn't load. It doesn't create a button. It is.
Professor, do you have to specify the input for the button, the input attribute?
I'm not actually having any inputs in this case. I only want to create a button.
Okay, my bad.
No. It's for some reason the code is correct. So I'm making some other mistake. Ah! I think it's because I was moving it around to show it properly. So let me see if this works. No. And it doesn't seem to, I think I played too much with this example. This seems to be correct. I'm not sure why this doesn't work. Let me see if the next one works. It's exactly the same, but is using jQuery instead of JavaScript. Maybe I'm making some mistake. Yeah, here it works. I can basically hide it. So what's the difference? Seems to me that I have no difference between the two, except that here. Wait,
Professor, I think there's an extra greater than bracket. Yeah, I think it's because of that.
Where is the extra greater?
Right there on your blinking cursor, like next to click too high.
Yeah.
The C, yeah. This
one?
Yeah. I think you need that.
I need that. It's the big end of this open
for no, don't. Oh yeah.
Because the JavaScript code is here between the double quotes.
Oh.
So this is just the property for on click that. Do I need to put that in a function? Not that, no. I basically can put directly the code that gets run. So.
Is it because you have to put like hashtag two?
It might be.
You get element by. This is how we did it last time. Somebody is proposing on click, but I don't think, we test it. Who knows? I may make a. No. It doesn't show the button. So the button, for some reason, it disappears.
Wait, Professor, how about you make a button from scratch and then just copy and paste the code in there.
Yeah, let's do that. Let me see if this works. Basically, this only creates a button that doesn't do anything. And now it's fine. So now what I deleted was the JavaScript that gets run. So I basically, I get the element with ID 2. For the parent node, I remove the child, which is the document with ID 2. And this parenthesis closes the 2. This parenthesis closes the remove child, and everything seemed to be fine.
Maybe check it now. The color looks different for the code.
Okay. Ah. It doesn't work, but
maybe it's the parentheses, because when you copy and paste it. Yeah, not parentheses, the quotes.
Something worked, but somebody is saying something that I have, maybe it's the quotations, the word character Unicode.
I think the C for onClick should be lowercase.
Yeah. So maybe something happened. No.
Professor, maybe type that line from scratch and see if it works.
Yep, it looks to me that that's the way to do it. So, good. Ah, there is a special character also in the code that was at the end. So there are some kind of weird characters going on because of PowerPoint, but let's see. Document.getElementById. Then we get element 2. For that element 2, let's use single quotes. 2. That for that element 2, I get parent node. For that, I remove child. And for that, I get the document. Dot get element by ID 2. And that should do the trick. Okay. I have single quotes inside here, outside I have double quotes. Okay, let's see if this works. Nope. Anyway, that's why we should use jQuery, because jQuery simplifies this entire thing. So basically what I'm doing here, I'm getting the button by using the tag button, and I specify the action that on click for that button, the function that gets executed is to get the two and hide it. So the same code without having to type this long command that we did in JavaScript can be easily done in jQuery. And as we can see, it works pretty well. So at least it's a good reason why we should use jQuery and not do it in JavaScript. Also, jQuery has the facility to update and query HTML. We'll return back to that if we have time after the class. We'll get it next time. Yes, that's true. Okay, good. So if you want to either set or return the content, a text content of an element that you selected, you can basically get text, or you can set the text to a different value. Similarly, for the HTML document, you can set or return the content, and the value for fields, you can set and return the value and the attributes for tags. And here is an example. So for instance, if I want to get the text under some object with ID 1, I can basically get the text and create an alert for it. Similarly, if I want to get the HTML for an object with ID 1, I can basically get that and get the HTML for it. if I have another button and I want to get the text for an object, the attribute href for an object with attribute 3 and maybe set it with a different value, our class website, I can basically get the attribute for href. And similarly, if I want to set the text to a different value, so here I'm using it in an expression, so it basically gets the value for the text and is used in a functional alert, while here I'm getting the same text and I'm setting the text to be hello world for that ID. Or in this case, I'm setting directly the HTML for that ID test to be this text. And here I'm setting, let's say that for some href, for some anchor with ID test 3, I had a certain website, like for instance, our course website, and I want to set it to our department website. I can basically do it the same way. So let me show you the examples. So let's take this document that we just wrote it here and directly put it in the console. Control Shift I is for Windows to get the console directly. So the first example, basically I want the value of some attribute. So alert, and for the attribute, let's say with ID 1, I'm getting the text for that attribute and I'm putting it in an alert. So now it basically says, this is the text from paragraph 1 is in the alert. I want to set the attribute 1 with to a different text. So basically, let's say here I have some text, a different text. And now it basically changed the attribute value directly. Similarly, if I want the HTML, so instead of the text, I want the pure HTML, I basically get a different text because that's actually HTML within that element. And if I want to set it to a different value, maybe I want to set it to an H tag 2 and then some value title 2. Now I basically changed that to a different title. If I would have had a link and I would have wanted to change the attribute href for that link, I could have basically done that too, but I don't want to basically show that example. Okay, also jQuery can update content. You can append content to an element at the end. You can prepend content at the beginning. You can add after as a sibling element, you can add before as a sibling element, you can remove directly the selected element like we did in that example here, where we removed basically, or we hid the element 2. You can even remove that element directly from the DOM, and you can empty the child elements of the selected element. So here are some examples. For H1, I'm basically appending extended header. So this is something that we can already have an H1 in our document. So I can basically add additional text in the header, extended header. If I want to prepend some value, basically that will be added before the current element. If I want to add basically another element before the current element as a sibling, I can do that after as a sibling, remove that element whatsoever, and basically empty the entire tag, the entire element. So for instance, in this case, let's say that I want to remove it completely. Remove this element, it basically removes that H1 title. If I want to remove the H2, it removes that one. If I want to remove every paragraph, it removes all of the paragraphs. If I want to even remove the button, it removes the button. Okay. So that's basically this example. Okay. jQuery can also fetch and update styles like CSS styles. And there are three forms to add to basically get the style. You can get the value of the property, like for instance, what is the color or the background color of a certain object by just using the CSS function for that object that you selected. You can set a certain property to a certain value, like the background color to blue, or actually a value for blue. And another way is to set multiple properties for CSS. So it's similar to what we did for multiple actions, CSS, and then you specify an object with all of the property value pairs separated by commas. So let's see in the chat, there are several questions. So one of you actually said that it's working as it was on my site. So probably actually multiple of you are saying that. So I assume that it actually worked, but something else might have happened. It works with live server. It works by just opening the HTML. You're using the DOM for the homework. You're basically loading one HTML, but in order to hide and show the class descriptions, you're using the DOM. So basically you can use it in one function like we did it in the quiz last time, or you can write separate selectors and functions for every single object. It's really up to you. You have many different ways to do it, like we did last time in JavaScript, or like we did today with jQuery. Please post any other questions that you have about the homework in Piazza. Okay, how can you traverse the document tree? So similar like we did in one example, we got the parent for a certain object, you can do it in jQuery. So dot parent returns the parent of the current element, parents returns the entire chain of parents from the current node to the HTML tag on top. Children returns all of the children of the current element. Find searches an element within the descendants of the current element. Siblings returns all the siblings of a certain type. Next returns the next sibling if you are iterating over basically the siblings. Next all returns all of the following siblings. Next until returns all of the siblings, stopping at the name sibling before the end. Previous returns the previous sibling. Previous all returns all of the previous siblings, and previous until the all the siblings until a name sibling is reached. So let me show you these examples. So basically the same document that we had before, and these are numbered 1, 2, 3. So if I want the for the first document 1, I select it and I want the parent. Basically it should return the HTML, the div, because basically I have a division defined right above the parent. So it basically returns this parent as the parent of the node 1. If I want all of the parents up to HTML, so it should return the div, the body, and the HTML tag. If I want after this, the next sibling, it returns 2. And after 2, I can basically write a pat expression. I want the next one after the next one, and that will return the next element in the list. In this case, is 4. For the element 2, I want the previous element. I basically get 1 because there's a previous element to 2 in this tag. Other examples, all the children under a tag. So for instance, I have the div tag and I want all of the children. of the div tag, and that's h1, 1, 2, the paragraph 4, the button. Next, all the following siblings. So basically, for this example, all of the siblings after 1 are 2, 4, and button. Next, until, I will just skip it because it's basically the same idea. Okay, good. So any questions? Leftover questions about jQuery? Is nothing in the chat, and it's 6 o'clock, 5:59. So I think this is all for today. Next time we will cover, as I said, Canvas, which is basically similar to a standalone application that you can use for drawing. HTML5 was released with Canvas, which basically gives us a way to draw lines, polygons, images, anything that we want in HTML. And that's basically used for games these days. You don't need to write applets anymore or to use Flash. You can basically implement really a game directly in HTML with JavaScript.
Wait, Professor, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Like, you know those website builders like WordPress?
Yes.
Like, if we can use that, why do we need to learn JavaScript? Like, I'm just asking out of curiosity.
No, it's a good question. Basically, WordPress can be used. It's a content management website. It lets you build a blog. It lets you build a lot of applications, including even billing or other things. But they are really canned, basically, functionalities. So you can't develop things that were not before implemented. So if you want to, let's say, develop, like I give you the assignment, this is assignment, implement a class find, an SBO class find. You probably can do it with Drupal or WordPress, but it's going to be quite painful because it's a lot of specialized features. You want to basically build all kinds of searches, filters. So this is really kind of like the difference that you can implement things directly in Java, or you can implement them with wireframes in, I don't know, Objective-C or Swift.
So you have more flexibilities.
Exactly.
Flexibility.
Okay. And you should actually learn to how to do it yourself from scratch. So that's why we are learning JavaScript, HTML, and in the end, server-side scripting.
Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, good. So I guess that's all the questions for today. I hope that this actually worked. And let me try to stop recording.